Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents See You at the Campground, a guide to discovering community, connection, and a happier family in the great outdoors. By Stephanie Puglisi and Jeremy Puglisi. Narrated by Emily Durante and Eric Michael Summerer. Introduction. See You at the Campground. Stephanie and Jeremy. This is supposed to be a book about camping, and it is, mostly. We promise to share the highs and lows of our family camping experiences over the past 10 years. We'll give you the best tips and tricks we know for finding the perfect campgrounds and planning amazing camping vacations. The words camping and campground will be used a lot. We pinky swear, hand to heart, scout's honor. But in reality, this story isn't about the types of recreational vehicles, RVs, tents, or cabins we have stayed in over the last decade. It's about the journey, the view out the window, the couple trying to figure out their marriage, the little kids buckled up in the back seat, the rescue pup on the floor of the truck waiting patiently for yummy crumbs to fall. It's about all the lessons we have learned and are still learning. It's about two parents who were trying to figure out what a happy family life actually looked like, since they didn't have much of a track record to draw on. It's about two high school sweethearts who knew they loved each other and didn't know a whole heck of a lot else about life. In a random twist of fate, desperately grasping at straws, they said, "Hey, let's buy a pop-up camper." In hindsight, it's hard to say why we landed on this particular solution to our particular problem. Our relationship was on the rocks, and being the parents of twin babies was giving us a run for our money. We knew that we needed to bring some serious fun back into our lives, but a pop-up camper? Really? Most reasonable people would just start going to the gym or put some date nights on the calendar. Well, we decided to pick up camping as our new family hobby and ended up transforming ourselves, our marriage, and our family life. Sometimes we feel pretty silly talking about how a little pop-up camper changed our lives, but we say it anyway, because it's true. Maybe you find yourself in the same situation we were in. We mostly loved our home, we mostly loved our jobs. We were attached to many of our little daily routines, like enjoying coffee and breakfast sandwiches at the playground on Saturday mornings. But we also wanted more. As soon as we became parents, we felt this immediate pressure to dive into a lifestyle full of family-friendly activities. It seemed like all the normal parents filled their weekends with touch-a-truck events, Chuck E. Cheese birthday parties, and endless, but necessary, household chores. As we slipped into these routines and patterns in our family life, we were left feeling bored, restless, and stressed out. So we decided to stop trying to fit into someone else's mold. We decided the great outdoors was big and full of opportunities for adventure. We decided outside was probably a better place for our loud and energetic kids than inside some plastic play center. We decided we could have just as much fun with kids as we'd had as a couple before they were born. We just had to write our own script, and our script included a pop-up camper. In the last decade, we've spent hundreds of nights camping with our kids. We've taken them to national parks, urban destinations, historical monuments, and sandy beaches. We've camped in rustic state parks and off-the-hook luxury campground resorts. All three of our boys learned to ride their bikes at campgrounds. They also learned to fish, hike, kayak, and paddleboard. We've tent camped in the Oregon coast and towed an RV to Mount Rushmore. We've eaten tacos in Texas and lobsters in Maine. Sometimes we joke that our boys experienced more in the first 10 years of their lives than either of us did in our first 3 decades. For our family, the campground has become a place where we disconnect from the demands of daily life and reconnect with each other. It's a place where we enjoy time with friends or just spend a quiet weekend together. It can be a base camp for exploring new destinations or a familiar place we return to year after year. The campground is where we start the day eating breakfast at the picnic table and end the day making s'mores around the campfire. The campground is a place for us to be together without the countless distractions of to-do lists, projects, and devices. The script you choose to write for your family might be a bit different, and that's okay. You don't need an RV to step off the hamster wheel of daily life and find fun and adventure with your family in the great outdoors. You don't need to take an epic cross-country road trip or even leave your home state. You might just decide to dust off that old tent or try out a cabin rental at a nearby campground. If you are looking to call a timeout for your family and take a break from the endless tasks and responsibilities of day-to-day life, we'll help you forge a new path. We want to inspire you to get outside, play in the dirt, and have fun together. See new sights, learn new things, take that road trip you've been dreaming about. It can feel a bit overwhelming, but our practical tips and real-life experiences will help you do it all without losing your mind. We know life is busy. We know there are bathrooms to clean, lawns to mow, and endless piles of laundry to wash. But there are also mountains to climb, fish to catch, and campfires to build. So in the midst of all the busyness, we hope you are inspired to escape to the campground every once in a while. The campground is a special place for our family. Time slows down, the noisiness of life fades into the background, and we connect as a family in the simplest ways possible through cooking a meal over a campfire or playing a card game at the picnic table. We are also intimately familiar with all the roadblocks that keep families from getting to this place. We know that it can seem overwhelming to plan camping trips, research an RV purchase, pack for a family vacation, and survive that road trip with your kids. This book will make tackling all of those details as simple as possible. We've done it the hard way at times and learned a lot of valuable lessons that we're happy to pass along. So here's the roadmap that we've used to find adventure and joy on our journey as a family. We hope it helps make your own journey a bit easier and a lot more fun. We'll see you at the campground. Chapter 1. Reasons Camping Vacations Are Better. Stephanie. The first few decades of our lives were rather unremarkable. Jeremy and I were classic high school sweethearts who got married right after college and immediately dove into our professional careers as educators. We hopped around the country a bit as we earned our master's degrees, but ultimately ended up settling in the same place where we were both born and raised, the Jersey Shore. As we inched toward our 30s, we checked off all the typical boxes. We suffered through terrible first jobs that barely paid for ramen noodle dinners. We lived in a professor's cramped attic apartment and a grandparent's basement as we struggled to pay off student loans. We eventually found better-paying jobs and finally bought a house. Our lives were fairly typical for a young married couple living in the suburbs of New Jersey. Except for one thing, we were total road warriors. We simply loved road trips. We'd fill up the car with gas, pop in our favorite mixtape, and drive for hours and hours. Our first official road trip took place back when we were still teenagers and decided on a whim to head south to the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Festival. We stayed in the diviest hostel imaginable, got pulled over by the Alabama police on the way home, and got our car broken into the night before we finally made it home. It was the best trip ever. Over the next few years, most of our road trips involved driving back and forth to each other's colleges. I went to school in Michigan, and Jeremy stayed in New Jersey, so we both became pros at clocking 11 hours behind the wheel without breaking a sweat. In later years, we drove cross-country so Jeremy could attend graduate school in California. And when my immediate family relocated to North Carolina, we would drive to the beautiful Blue Ridge Mountains from New Jersey at least 3 times a year. Sometimes I wonder if it all really started there, So many of the most exciting moments of our lives happened when we got behind the wheel and drove. I think that over the years, road trips became deeply connected with our idea of adventure as a couple. Then everything got a bit more complicated. Our twin boys, Max and Theo, were born in May 2009. We were both teachers at the time, so the whole summer stretched in front of us, and we had absolutely no idea how to fill it up. Before kids came along, our summers had been jam-packed with side gigs, a little bit of travel, and a lot of beach time. Now, with two newborn babies, we certainly weren't going to work a summer job or plan a road trip. But sitting on the beach relaxing with the boys seemed like a reasonable prospect, until we tried it a few times. Now, let's be clear. Plenty of people take their newborns to the beach and have a lovely time. We just aren't those people. It was so much work for so very little reward. We would spend hours packing everything up and figuring out how to get it all down to the beach without dropping a baby in the process. Then we would huddle under the umbrella, rocking or feeding the boys and trying not to get sand in their eyes. The saddest part of all was when we had to take turns going for a swim in the ocean, one at a time, while the other sat on the blanket hoping that both babies didn't start crying at the same time. There were definitely sweet moments when we walked down the shoreline with both boys napping in carriers, but those were the exception, not the rule. 2 weeks into summer, we admitted to each other that we weren't particularly enjoying our time off as a brand new family. It was time to shift gears. Our summers before kids had always included some sort of road trip adventure. We rarely flew anywhere, preferring to load up the car and drive 12 hours at a clip, often through the night. We loved playing music, listening to our favorite radio programs, and stopping at divey roadside joints for pancakes at midnight. That summer, sometime in early July, we sat on the floor of our living room, each of us holding a 2-month-old baby, trying to figure out what we were going to do with the next 7 weeks. Then one of us suggested a road trip. We don't remember who said it first, but either way, we were both on board immediately. Sure, it seemed a little crazy. The same people who were getting stressed out going to the beach with newborn twins were now going to go on vacation. Yet, in another way, it made perfect sense. The learning curve for becoming a parent is pretty steep, but there was one lesson we had learned quickly. Relaxing and having fun look very different once you have kids. You can't just expect to go to the beach, surf a few waves, and read a good book while soaking up some rays. But something inside of us was certain that we could still have fun. We just had to recalibrate and shift our notion of what it meant to relax and enjoy time together. We were also picking up on a simple truth about our boys that remains true to this day. Even as tiny babies, they were at their best when we were moving and having an adventure. Sitting still doesn't suit them now, and it didn't suit them when they were 2 months old. Whenever they would get fussy, a walk or a car ride would calm them right down. So it really didn't seem crazy to think about a road trip with newborns. Sitting around attempting to enjoy the lazy days of summer just wasn't working. It was time to try another approach. Since my parents had relocated to North Carolina, the Asheville area had become one of our favorite road trip destinations. So that afternoon, sitting on the floor of the living room with napping babies on our chests, we decided to make the 13-hour drive down to the Blue Ridge Mountains. What could go wrong? We had done that drive dozens of times in the past, and my parents had a spare bedroom where we could all camp out for a couple of weeks. Asheville is full of amazing live music, awesome restaurants, and beautiful hikes just a short drive from downtown. It was like Fun Times was flashing in neon lights right before our very eyes. It is no exaggeration to say that 24 hours later, the car was packed and we were headed south. Now, Max and Theo were just about 2 months old at this point. We didn't exactly have the whole baby thing dialed in yet, much less the whole drive for 13 hours with two babies on board thing. Looking back, it's hard to believe that we made it down to North Carolina in one piece. Because the boys had napped so well in the car around town, we'd probably figured that they would just sleep away the 13-hour drive. Of course, that's not what happened. The boys took turns crying for the entire drive. And it hadn't occurred to us that the journey would take 2 hours longer since we had to stop to feed the newborns constantly. But we survived, barely. And I may or may not have bought noise-canceling headphones for the ride home a couple of weeks later. This was the very first time we tried to have an adventure with our kids, and we learned a lot, because to be completely honest, it was a bit of a disaster. First of all, staying in a spare room in your parents' house with newborn twins is not as easy as it may seem. Our boys were terrible sleepers, and we felt awful that they were waking up the whole household multiple times every night. My parents probably didn't mean to make us feel guilty, but the bleary-eyed breakfasts where everyone recounted how many times they were woken up the night before left us feeling like interlopers in someone else's territory. Then there was the shocking realization that it's a little more difficult to enjoy upscale restaurants and urban nightlife with a couple of newborns in tow. Jeremy would pore over the weekly Mountain Express and silently come to terms with all the bands that he would not be seeing during our stay. Yes, we probably should have had more realistic expectations about our activity schedule, and there might have been a tiny piece of me that was expecting my family to share some of the baby caretaking burden, which didn't end up happening. Nobody insisted on babysitting while we went out for the first time since having the boys. That's okay, since nobody owes you free babysitting in life. Unfortunately, it's a lesson many of us have to learn the hard way. All told, a lot of parents might have walked away from the experience feeling defeated by their first attempt at an epic family adventure. Not us. We are professionally trained teachers who seem to be compelled to view everything in life as a learning experience. For most of the ride home, whenever I wasn't wearing my noise-canceling headphones, we dissected the ins and outs of the great family road trip of 2009. A couple of big takeaways kept coming up over and over. First, we had a ton of fun doing things that we hadn't done a lot in the past. Hiking, for one. Some of our greatest memories from that trip are of strapping the boys into their baby Bjorn carriers and finding great walking trails around Mount Mitchell. FYI, the Balsam Nature Trail at the summit of Mount Mitchell loops through a fairy tale fir forest, and the hike is the perfect length for a newborn's nap. And second, road food. We gained a new appreciation on this trip for roadside barbecue joints with outdoor picnic tables and plenty of room for our Bob two-seat jogging stroller. Noise and mess are par for the course in this environment, which suited us perfectly. Our obsession with finding great places to eat has only grown throughout the years. It's amazing to look back and realize that our family tradition of seeking out the best road food joints around the country started a decade ago at 12 Bones Smokehouse in Arden, North Carolina. So as we pulled into our driveway in New Jersey, we were exhausted, of course, but also delighted with ourselves for coming up with our next big idea. Traveling with the twins was obviously an awesome experience, worth the hard work and effort. We just needed to pivot away from the whole extended family thing and have our own space, perhaps in a hotel, right? Like most ideas conceived after a 15-hour car ride, this ended up being a bad one. But we were totally committed. Life was busy as the next school year kicked off and we both went back to work. There wasn't time for any more amazing family adventures. But soon enough, that claustrophobic feeling started to kick in, and we were looking at each other and asking, what should we do? Where should we go? At this point, we thought we knew everything. First of all, getting out of the house and shaking up the routine with our boys was a good thing. Second, staying in someone else's house with infant twins was a bad thing. So we decided to take advantage of a well-timed Groupon deal. We nabbed a room at the Kokokee Water Resort, a hotel that was only 2 hours away and, wait for it, had an on-site water park. The plan was to pair some kid-friendly fun with nearby urban shopping and dining. Enter the hotel stay from hell. It's hard to imagine if you haven't experienced it personally. The sheer horror of watching crawling babies put their hands and mouths on every single filthy thing still sends shivers down our spines. Every item in the hotel room was a potential danger, so we spent the entirety of our time in the room chasing the boys around and making sure they didn't eat the carpet fuzz. And then there was bedtime. Max and Theo were always early risers, which also meant that they were a special kind of torture past 7 p.m. So there we were, at normal people's dinner time, drawing the curtains, turning on the noise machine, and shushing our living brains out to get the tiny terrors to sleep. They would start drifting off, and then someone would run down the hall yelling. Their eyes would fly open, and unseemly words would fly out of our mouths. Televisions, elevators, room service. You don't realize how much noise there is in a hotel until you try to put a baby to sleep in one. After what seemed like hours, the boys were finally asleep, and we were giving each other quiet fist bumps in the pitch-black hotel room. It took a minute for reality to set in. Max and Theo were out like lights, and we wanted them to stay that way. So the next few hours of our lives would entail remaining absolutely silent in a dark hotel room. There's an exciting Saturday night for you. 20 minutes later, we were perched on the edge of the bathroom tub, drinking ginger ale, eating pretzels, and sharing a single set of earphones as we watched back-to-back episodes of Top Chef on our laptop. The epic sadness of the moment was not lost on us. In fact, years later, we can still feel the disappointment of that hotel stay deep in our bones. If we had a picture of us in that moment, it would be best captioned, "Oh, how the mighty have fallen." In the morning, we packed up our bags and a ridiculous amount of baby gear and drove home before most of the other hotel guests were even awake. The Hotel from Hell adventure took place in late fall. That was the last time we set foot in a hotel with our boys for many, many years, until we could be sure that no one would eat the carpet fuzz. But on the drive home that day, we started hammering out plans for our next big idea, the family pop-up camper. Jeremy and I might have been road warriors, but we were definitely not seasoned campers. We had both had just enough camping experiences throughout the years to imagine that a pop-up camper would be the answer to the question of how we were going to have epic adventures with our little kids in tow. When I was growing up, my father was a contractor who worked hard and rarely took time off. He was also an Eagle Scout, so when we did take the rare family vacation, it involved a mint green station wagon, a giant army-issued canvas tent, and a platoon of red Coleman coolers stuffed with food my mother would prepare for weeks in advance. Most years, we would head to Assateague State Park in Maryland for an end-of-summer camping trip with family friends. Sometimes, my parents borrowed a pop-up camper from some folks we knew pretty well. As a result of my childhood, a pop-up camper seemed like the pinnacle of luxury. You see, us kids weren't even allowed inside. We had to stay in that 8-man army tent while my parents enjoyed the comfort of dry, elevated mattresses. I remember standing in the doorway, peeking in, imagining how good life would be if we could just sleep in that pop-up camper instead of in a damp, musty sleeping bag. I think that idea stuck with me for decades afterward. In my mind, a pop-up camper was a comfortable little hotel on wheels that you could take to beautiful places like Assateague State Park. I had floated this idea to Jeremy over the years, but it had never really gained any traction. It took a couple of really bad travel experiences with infants for my pop-up camper idea to actually stick. See, we weren't just struggling to be parents. We were also struggling to be a couple. In some ways, Jeremy and I had always been that opposites attract kind of couple, and that worked okay when it was just the two of us. I was a morning person. He was a night owl. He liked to go out. I loved to stay in. I went to yoga on Saturdays, while Jeremy went to play basketball. We ping-ponged off of each other, enjoying time together, and then going off and enjoying our own version of fun. Having twins challenged that dynamic. Anytime that one of us was solo with two babies, it felt like the loneliest and longest time in the world. We experienced all the typical stress points for young parents, juggling work and childcare, middle-of-the-night wakings, and the never-ending parade of sicknesses. Over the previous decade, my entire immediate and extended family had moved out of the state of New Jersey. To be honest, their absence hadn't affected us too strongly before we had kids. We visited a few times a year and talked on the phone daily. Jeremy and I were busy in our careers and lives. But when the twins arrived, loneliness and isolation became an acute condition for both Jeremy and me. We knew we loved each other, but it was hard to really connect as a couple while feeling so overwhelmed by our daily circumstances. Our 10th wedding anniversary was looming on the horizon, and it felt very symbolic to both of us. Would our marriage survive this shift from being a couple to being parents? We both needed some grand romantic gesture, and a luxurious European getaway was simply not in the cards. But a pop-up camper? We could definitely swing that. Over the course of the winter, Jeremy dove into the research, since he is the shopper in our relationship. I mostly stayed out of the process because spending money stresses me out. We never even considered other RV options. A pop-up camper was affordable. It could fit in our very small driveway, and it could be towed by our Toyota Highlander SUV. Done, done, and done. By April, just a month before the boys celebrated their first birthday, Jeremy was backing a brand new pop-up camper into the driveway. We weren't giving up. That pop-up camper wasn't just an RV. It was our all-in bet. We were putting all the chips on the table and crossing our fingers for a big win. We were a family, and darn it, we wanted to be a happy one. Reasons camping vacations are better. These days, we give a lot of educational seminars at RV shows, and over the last few years, we've met hundreds of families who are wondering if camping is right for them. Some of them camped when they were growing up and are looking to share that experience with their own kids. Other folks have never pitched a tent in their lives, but are looking to take a deep breath, call a timeout on the hectic pace of daily life, and spend more quality time with the family. Like us, they've had their fair share of experiences with hotels and Airbnbs, and they're curious about a different type of family vacation. We've certainly tried it all over the years, and here are the reasons we love camping vacations more than any other type of travel. If these reasons resonate with you, then you're on the right path. Camping lets you spend less and travel more. When we bought our first RV, we were two teachers with plenty of time to travel, but not a lot of disposable income. Camping allows us to control our expenses more than any other form of travel. We can drive shorter distances to save money on gas, prepare our own meals to save money on food, and stay in state and national parks to save money on campsites. The RV industry claims that RV vacations are about 50% cheaper than traditional vacations that include airline tickets and hotel accommodations. As we've tracked our expenses over the years, we've found that this is absolutely accurate for our travel budget. Even if we splurge on some resort camping experiences and a couple of meals out, our camping vacations remain about half the total cost of other family travel that we do throughout the year. Cost comparisons for camping vacations. According to a 2018 study conducted by CBRE Hotels Advisory Group, RV vacations cost much less than other types of vacation travel, even when factoring in fuel prices and the cost of RV ownership. The study found cost savings of 21 to 64% for a four-person family, while a two-person family saves 8 to 53%, depending on factors such as the type of RV, distance traveled, and accommodations. Average cost for a seven-day trip. RVing, $1,993 versus drive/hotel rental, $2,956. RVing, $1,993 versus fly/drive/hotel rental, $4,113. RVing, $1,993 versus fly/drive/house rental, $3,114. Campers are social people. It's no secret that a lot of families are struggling to find community these days. Many of us move to new locations for work or have family spread out around the country. It's hard to make new friends while you're busy working and raising kids. When we started camping, we didn't know anyone else who camped on a regular basis. However, that changed quickly enough. Campgrounds are a bit like neighborhoods of the past. Everyone is outside, waving as you walk by, and perfectly willing to stop and chat about the weather. We have met families at the campground who have become actual, real-life friends. We recently spent the weekend at a nearby campground with eight other families, none of whom we knew before we bought the pop-up camper. All the kids spent their time riding bikes, fishing, and playing wiffle ball. The adults sat around the campfire talking and laughing for hours. Where else does that happen these days? Campgrounds offer tons of room to roam. Campgrounds allow us to enjoy our time with the kids because we are not constantly trying to control their activity levels. Our boys love to run and jump and move, and campgrounds offer plenty of space for those sorts of shenanigans. In hotels or rented houses, we're always trying to stop our kids from running inside, jumping on the beds, and wrestling on the couch. At the campground, they can ride their bikes, run around at the playground, or play catch in the field. The outdoor space is a game changer for our family. Yes, we love the cost savings of camping, but given the choice between an equally priced hotel room or campground, we would still choose camping every time because of the value of that outdoor space for our family. Many campgrounds offer on-site activities and entertainment. The first time I priced out an all-inclusive getaway vacation for the family, my jaw dropped. I realized that a week on a Caribbean island would just about suck up all of our travel funds for the entire year. We never ended up taking that type of vacation because we discovered the world of resort campgrounds and never looked back. You might get sticker shock when you find out that there are campsites that cost $100 a night, but that price might actually be a steal when you consider the on-site activities and amenities included. Our favorite resort campgrounds have multiple pools, hot tubs, water slides, lazy rivers, and mini golf. Many have daily schedules jam-packed with ice cream socials, t-shirt tie-dyeing, and wiffle ball tournaments. At these campgrounds, we can arrive, set up camp, and stay at the resort for the entire vacation. It's our own affordable version of that all-inclusive Caribbean getaway that we never experienced. Families are spending more time camping than ever before, citing the motivation to be outdoors. Nightly campfire time is heaven. If you are anything like us, date nights are few and far between. At home, we put the kids to bed and then flop down, exhausted, in front of our separate screens. Even if we are in the same room, we're lost in our respective social media feeds or latest Netflix binges. The same thing occurs when we stay in hotel rooms with the kids. Lights go out, headphones go on, and we might as well be miles away from each other. The very first time we went camping, something magical happened. The babies fell asleep, and we found ourselves sitting around the campfire, simply chatting. It was the closest we had come to a real date in a very long time. Years later, our kids don't go to bed so early anymore, but that's okay. We cherish campfire time just as much now that we all enjoy it together. No matter how hard we try, we never manage to replicate that campfire magic when we're at home, distracted by our endless to-do lists and easy access to technology. The campfire has become a sacred place in our family, the place where we talk, laugh, sing songs, and eat s'mores. It's easy to travel with family and friends. Many campgrounds offer cabins, tenting areas, and RV sites, so there are different accommodations for anyone who wants to come along. We've had grandparents and neighbors stay in cabins while we parked our RV next door. We've done big, fun adventures where 10 kids had a sleepover in one tent. Oftentimes, we'll let our friends know that we've booked a spot at a local campground for an upcoming weekend. By the time the weekend rolls around, we'll have 3 or 4 other families joining us. We can all enjoy each other's company, sharing meals and competing in rowdy cornhole tournaments. Then we retreat to the comfort of our own space at the end of the day. It's been a wonderful way for us to build relationships with our friends and family over the years. Top reasons people say they go camping. 1. Camping is a time to just relax and not feel like I have to be somewhere or do something. 2. Camping is a great way for me to escape the stress of everyday life. 3. Camping allows me to clear my mind. 4. I like to camp as part of a group of friends and family. 5. Camping is an affordable vacation option. You can bring your 4-legged friends. Camping is ridiculously pet-friendly. It's estimated that more than 50% of people who own an RV also travel with at least one pet. I always knew that we would eventually want to bring a dog into the family since I had grown up with a gaggle of dogs and cats. When the time was right to adopt, it was such a relief that we could bring Maggie along on our camping adventures instead of putting her in doggy daycare every time we wanted to travel. It turns out that Maggie might just be the biggest camping fanatic in the family. She lives for long walks around the campground and is by far the most enthusiastic hiker out of all of us. You can bring your own food. We love a lot of things about camping trips, but this might be the one that is most important to us day in and day out. Eating all your meals out while traveling is expensive and exhausting with kids. It can also be unhealthy. But we can pack all our favorite foods in our RV's kitchen or in coolers before we leave on a trip. Plus, we can even prepare lunch at a rest stop on a travel day without ever having to go into those yucky fast food joints. This is one of the primary reasons that we will choose a cabin over a hotel room when we aren't traveling with our RV. Now that we know what it's like to have a kitchen while traveling, it's very hard for us to go without one. We've become completely spoiled. We love having home-cooked meals, no matter where we are. You get to reconnect with nature. I don't need an expert to tell me that we all spend too much time indoors and on our devices. The studies just tell us what we already know. We should be taking more walks and spending more time looking at the stars, but life somehow gets in the way. It's amazing how much more time you naturally spend outdoors when you are camping, even if you're staying in a cabin or RV. We eat breakfast at the picnic table, the kids run around at the playground, and we relax around the campfire at night. At home, our bikes stay in the garage for days at a time. At the campground, we ride them many times a day. Our dog gets walked more, and we take the time to relax in the hammock. To be completely frank, I think our boys spend more time outside when we are at home because of all the time spent outside at the campground. Over the years, they've learned to create their own fun out in nature, and I believe that has helped us in the constant battle against screen time. Sure, I have to turn off the TV and kick my kids outside just like any other parent, but they sure do know what to do with themselves once they're out there. We first bought our pop-up camper because we wanted to road trip in comfort, traveling with our own bed, gear, and food. It didn't take long for us to discover that there were so many more benefits to camping than we had realized. Now, whether we are traveling with our RV or flying to a destination, we know that campgrounds are the right choice for our family. Health benefits of camping. Various studies have proven the many health benefits of camping, including more fresh air, less stress, better sleep, more vitamin D, higher activity levels.
Chapter 2. Choose Your Own Camping Adventure. Jeremy. When Stephanie and I first bought that pop-up camper, we had no idea that American camping was entering a new golden age. In many ways, there has never been a better time to go camping. According to the 2019 North American Camping Report by Campgrounds of America, KOA, there are nearly 79 million camping households in the United States. Some of these families are tent campers, some are cabin campers, and others are RV owners. But no matter how they go camping, they have a wider variety of options for accommodations, experiences, and gear than any generation has had before. Right now is the perfect time for you to pitch a tent, hitch up an RV, or rent a cabin, and take your seat around the campfire. There is no wrong way to go camping. The only mistake you can make is staying home. Tent campers no longer have to deal with the leaky and antiquated canvas tents of the 1970s and 80s. In fact, they don't even need to sleep on the ground anymore. Cots and sleeping pads that are specifically designed for tenting have dramatically increased the comfort of a night spent in the woods. Today's tents are also surprisingly lightweight and waterproof. You don't have to worry about touching the canvas sides and flooding the tent like you did back in the 80s. RV ownership among Americans is also at an all-time high. This is largely because purchasing an RV is more affordable than it has ever been. After the Great Recession, many manufacturers began making a wider variety of lighter, less expensive RVs that can be towed by small pickup trucks, SUVs, and even the family minivan. Just walk around your neighborhood and take a look. There are probably RV owners living right on your block. Many Americans still associate the word RV with expensive motorhomes purchased by older folks after retirement, or with Cousin Eddie from National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation. But these are outdated notions. The average age of RV owners has declined significantly over the last decade. The van life movement has also exploded in recent years among millennials who are eager to hit the open road and embrace experience over consumerism. Many of these millennials witnessed their parents get burned in the housing crisis over a decade ago, and they have decided to avoid buying homes, at least for the time being, and to redefine the American dream by living a nomadic life on the road. Their camper vans run the gamut from remodeled Volkswagen Westphalias that were salvaged from the scrap heap to brand new Winnebagos with price tags that can easily reach $100,000. If you are looking for travel inspiration, just search for hashtag vanlife on Instagram. The dusty back roads and byways of the American West will burst to life and jump right off your screen. While these van lifers often skip traditional campgrounds for more remote, off-grid, boondocking spots, the RV industry is betting big that once they get a little bit older and have children of their own, we will see them at the campground en masse in shiny new travel trailers and motorhomes. As interest in the great outdoors continues to grow, so do cabin camping options. Those who want basic accommodations with a bed and roof over their heads can rent an affordable rustic cabin and find their inner Thoreau. Families who want a more luxurious experience can rent deluxe or premium cabins with kitchens, bathrooms, temperature control capabilities, and even flat-screen TVs. Your crusty old Uncle Joe might tell you that you're not really camping at this point, but have you ever listened to his advice anyway? Options for stylish and uniquely outfitted rentals, such as glamping tents, yurts, and teepees, have also exploded over the past decade. When the term glamping, short for glamorous camping, first appeared around 2005, it was often ridiculed by old guard tent campers and RV owners like Uncle Joe. But what initially started as a trend is starting to harden into an industry with real staying power. The recently launched American Glamping Association seeks to band together the growing number of campground owners who are offering, and profiting nicely from, these diverse and lavish accommodations. "We have glamped in luxurious, fully furnished canvas tents along the coasts of Oregon and Maine, and loved every second of it. If camping in a tent or towing your own RV is not right for you at the moment, a glamping experience might just fit the bill. But be prepared. The bill might be larger than you think. Hundreds of campgrounds are adding these types of deluxe accommodations, often right next door to their humbler tent and RV sites. The current diversity of campground accommodations is truly remarkable. There is something for everyone at every price point. And when I say everyone, I actually mean everyone. This is where the new golden age of American camping departs from its last iteration, and thankfully so. More than half of campers say they'd like to go glamping in the coming year. The first great golden age of American camping happened right after World War II and extended into the 1960s. Thousands of veterans returning from the war decided to see America first with their young families, and many of them chose to do so in tents and RVs, or while camping out of their cars in shiny new station wagons. Many state and national park campgrounds were brand new at that point, as was much of the interstate highway system, also known as the Dwight D. Eisenhower National System of Interstate and Defense Highways. Private campgrounds began to thrive in this era too, as enterprising individuals saw an opportunity to capitalize on the increase in highway travel. The Campgrounds of America franchise system, for example, which is now the largest in the country, was first established in Billings, Montana, after businessman Dave Drum observed waves of travelers passing through town on their way to the 1962 World's Fair in Seattle. It truly was a golden age for road tripping and American camping. We have to point out that, at that time, the vast majority of those campers were white. Today, campgrounds are becoming increasingly diverse. When we first started camping a decade ago, it was unusual to see minority families at the campground. In many parts of America, that trend is quickly becoming part of the past. According to racial and ethnic demographics reported in KOA's 2019 North American Camping Report, new campers who are just entering the lifestyle are actually more diverse than the overall U.S. population. Campgrounds are starting to look a lot more like America, and we couldn't be happier about that fact. No matter who you are or where you come from, we hope to see you at the campground. Heaven knows we spend a lot of time there ourselves. Our family usually heads to the campground in our own RV, but we have also rented cabins and stayed in tents. We love all of these options for a variety of reasons, and we think you should consider each of them seriously for your next family vacation. The diversity of accommodations at today's campgrounds are more robust than ever, but most Americans still take their first camping trip in a tent. And that's where it all started for me more than three decades ago.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.